Can you hear me well enough that I don't have to be trapped behind the microphone? Can you hear me okay?
No.
If you can't, just give me a wave. If you don't care, then get your feet. So today, Rogation Day. And it's an ancient practice, this time of year where we celebrate what I would refer to as right relationship with the land. It goes back into the times when we were more of an agricultural people. And it was a blessing of the tools, a blessing of the seed. It was really tuning in to the blessing that we live in, that the created order is a system, a well-oiled system that we are a part of and that we take our very life from, that we are a part of it, and it of course feeds us and we are part of it, and that we see that as a gift and blessing of the Creator. For most of human history, we were hunters and gatherers. And while we've come to understand that as time went on, there was more participation in some levels, you wouldn't call it agriculture, but things like using fire to burn off certain areas so that what would grow in there would be something, you know, if you wanted an area to produce blackberries, just get out of the way. But in this case, they would do things. So they would feed and grow certain things in certain areas, concentrate them there so that game would come, and that sort of thing. A very intimate relationship with the created order. And then some people figured out, well, if we can do those kinds of things, what if we started planting things together, put things, actually go out and plant stuff. So agriculture comes along. We start getting specialists. We have farmers and we have herdsmen, which frees up some people to become artists, to become writers, philosophers, priests, governments. That could have been. But we start to get specialists, and that's one step removed from the hunter-gatherers, that the whole people were not so intimately connected to the land. And then in the 18th century comes the Industrial Revolution. And while we certainly enjoy many of the benefits, that really was a huge step away from a relationship with the source of our food. There are kids today that don't know that vegetables are plants. It's just, you go to the store, you get it at Fred Meyer, or Safeway, or Winco, or you know, there's just this total disconnect from the source of it. The people that actually do the farming, we like to refer to them as illegals. We criminalize them, and yet they are the people who produce our food, and many of them that work for agribusiness are badly treated. They get diseases from the sprays that they get covered with. More and more and more detachment. With the electronic revolution, we're getting even further removed, because it won't be long before an Amazon drone will drop your groceries on your front porch. You don't even have to leave the house for that. Further and further removed. And removed into what? Into our creation. We become the source of life. We are the, we. Even agriculture. with monoculture and with all of the chemicals and the chemical fertilizers and the herbicides and pesticides and all that stuff. All the power of creation. And what's happening as that seems to go on, and I would make the argument that that is part of the isolation that people experience as we get more and more removed from the source of our very lives. But that just compounds the isolation that we experience. There are rays of hope. More and more we're finding small truck farmers who are using organic methods, returning to old methods. We're having more and more farmers markets. The garden to table movement. All of that moving back towards that source. And little things. Those of you who have been around here a while remember that this used to be what was called a garth, which is an English term for a church little orchard, little wooded area. But because of some underground drainage problems, it had turned into a swamp. So it was decided to remove all that and lay this brick. Immediately there was this feeling that, what are we doing? It's going from this green thing to this, just the brick. So what was the response? You bring stuff in and pot. We have this need to have green growing things around us. And now, it's probably a better garth than it ever was before. Because we have these green growing things and we don't have to stand in a box. We could never have this service here before. It was a garth. People are gardening. And anyone who has a garden more than 1 year knows how much it feeds more than our bellies, but our soul. And some folks, even just having a little potted plant in the kitchen, know that having that relationship with that little plant can be, it keeps you company. It's the difference between isolation and companionship. It might just be a little pot of aloe vera. There's something about being in this relationship with growing things. We act like, whether we truly believe that we were brought here by aliens or not, we act like that we're separate from, that somehow we came along and got plopped down into something else, some place, some environment. But we are a part of it. And when we are in harmony with it, even to the degree of the aloe vera in the kitchen window, it feeds us, and there is a rightness about that. There is a rightness about being in that relationship. It seems to me that if we look at ancient peoples, ancient Christians, especially Celtic Christians, we were just born of all hopefulness, the tune that we did the song by, brings that. But there's this recognition of the sacramental nature of creation. And in many ways, especially when it comes to the growing of food, the elements that we're going to partake of shortly, bread and wine, are an example of that. it's an outward invisible sign of this deep and profound inward grace that we experience in a relationship with God through Christ. And the vehicle is something that comes from the land. Bread and wine. It's all an integrated whole. And when we enter into that and recognize our part in it, then that whole notion of the body of Christ, that we are one in Christ, not just with each other, but with these trees that are raining their blessings down. This day is just the beginning of a whole season. We've come through, we've weathered the darkness and the rain. Rain may not go away, but the darkness has for a while. And we come out and we notice all of the beauty that we're surrounded by. Trees are in bloom, the roses are ready. It's remarkable. It's a time. We start to get stuff out of our gardens. There's nothing quite like it. In our house, there's nothing much better than going out with my little cereal bowl and picking the blueberries and the raspberries and sitting on the back porch, eating my cereal with blueberries and raspberries, going out later, collecting stuff for a salad out of the garden. There's nothing quite like it. As I said, there's that rightness to it. So this day, let us, as we enter this season, that liturgically is the season of new life, of Easter. How appropriate. How appropriate is that for this season of new life in the Lord calling? Carry that with you into these days. And give you work on those gardens. Amen.